warm welcome to this cold Berlin now. Dear Professor Castro-Varela, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for convening this conference and for giving me the opportunity to say a few words to you today. This conference is important because it shines a light on the tragedy, the suffering of untold numbers of people who are being systematically deprived of their rights and their dignity, who are being displaced, tortured, raped, murdered. We Greens condemn these crimes against humanity in the sharpest terms. In its annual report published last week, Amnesty International describes the fate of the Rohingyas as the fastest growing refugee crisis 2017. I quote, "The army committed extensive violations of international humanitarian law. Impunity persisted for past and ongoing human rights violations." And Amnesty warns that every day the task of defending human rights begins again. In the Bundestag, the German parliament, we are currently working on a cross-party resolution calling for an end to the atrocities against the Rohingyas and for their full recognition as an ethnic group with equal rights in Myanmar. I hope that it will be adopted in March at the latest. We Greens attach a great deal of importance to this initiative, particularly to the following demands. First, human rights violations against the Rohingya in Myanmar must end immediately. They must be fully investigated and the perpetrators brought to justice. Second, the Rohingya have a right to citizenship. They are entitled to full civil and political rights. This means that they themselves must be directly involved in decision making about their own future. Third, humanitarian organizations, journalists, and UN observers must have unrestricted access to Rakhine State. The fact-finding mission appointed by the UN Human Rights Council back in March 27th must be granted full access to Rakhine. Fourth, the European Union existing arms embargo must be extended. Much more also needs to be done at UN level to ensure that no weapons are delivered to Myanmar, in other words, into the hands of those who are committing crimes against humanity, this textbook example for ethnic cleansing against a Muslim minority. These descriptions, I should point out, come from the UN Human Rights Council and the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights. Fifth, for the Rohingya, there must be no forced return agreed over their heads, certainly not to regions where terrible suffering has been inflicted on them, where they face the threat of renewed hostility, or where, in the interim, they have been deprived of their land and property. Ladies and gentlemen, let me come back to the latest Amnesty International report. One of its bitter but sadly accurate observations is that the response of the leaders of the world's wealthier countries to the global refugee crisis is a mixture of ignorance and a lack of basic human compassion. Refugees are so often seen not as people with rights, but as a problem to be avoided. Unfortunately, this reaction is becoming more prevalent here in affluent Europe too. Not among the countless citizens and organizations that are providing wonderful support on a voluntary and altruistic basis, but among politicians that all the way up to government leaders who embrace isolationism or even toy with xenophobia in order to catch votes. We must stand up against these tendencies. We must show solidarity. For example, with countries like Bangladesh, themselves so poor, and yet at least making the attempt at present to give shelter to refugees from neighboring Myanmar. Bangladesh cannot manage this task alone. It needs more support, bilateral and multilateral. We must look at what is happening and call human rights violations by their real name, wherever and whenever they occur, regardless of the supposedly overarching interest. Thank you for listening. I wish your conference every success. Thank you.